Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jeff Badnock, and on behalf of the Alumni Association Community Lecture Series Committee, it's my pleasure and honor to welcome you to our fifth lecture, and I have, as always, a couple of announcements. First of all, silence your phones. Get that out of the way. Other information that I'm supposed to give you tonight is our series, tentatively now, we're not confirmed yet, but we think it will begin rebroadcast on the MCAT channel 189 beginning Wednesday, April 1st at 7 p.m. and repeating the following Thursday at 6 p.m. And like the lecture series, it will run for 6 weeks. So if for some reason you missed a lecture, if you want to share the lectures with friends or family, that's when it will be on. It'll be on MCAT. And there will be available of the schedule. The schedule will be available next week that'll have the confirmed information. Secondly, last week I promised you if you were interested in the playlist of the music that we listened to before the lectures, they are available there under the announcement or the poster for the lecture series, and we have some more outside. It's from my record collection. I didn't know there were so many songs about the moon, but there are, it turns out, very, very many songs about the moon. Next week, we will hold our customary end-of-series reception, and it will be held right outside the theater where our speakers will be available for a conversation. We'll have some refreshments and celebrate another successful lecture series. Because MCAT is recording the lectures, as we get to the end of the lecture and we have our question and answer period, we'll have microphones available. When they come around to hand you the microphone to have you ask your question, talk directly into the microphone so that we can capture your question on the videotape. If you hold the microphone any other way, we'll lose your question and the answer won't be as meaningful to the people who watch the videos. As always, we're going to introduce tonight's lecture with a poem. This poem is by American poet Ted Hughes, who passed away recently. And it's a poem, I think he wrote it for his daughter. It's called Full Moon and Little Frida. A cool small evening shrunk to a dog bark and the clink of a bucket. And you listening. A spider's web tense for the dew's touch. A pail lifted, still and brimming. Mirror to tempt a first star to a tremor. Cows are going home in the lane there, looping the hedges with their warm wreaths of breath, a dark river of blood, many boulders, balancing unspilled milk. Moon! You cry suddenly. Moon! Moon! The moon has stepped back like an artist, gazing amazed at a work that points at him amazed. I'd like you to all join me in welcoming tonight's lecturer, Rob Browning, who will talk about one of my very, very favorite films. Rob?
How many of you have seen 2001? Ah, that's good. How many of you like it? How many of you don't like it? Good audience. Okay, I wish I could say the same of my science fiction class this week. They're a little more split, 50-50. How many of you have read the novel? Okay. And has anyone seen, or did anyone see the film in 1968, its first year out? Wow. I would love to talk with some of you about that experience. So I have a personal connection with this film. We're the same age. The film was released in April of 1968, and I was released a couple months later. And so I was looking, when the film came out, something like this. Only not quite so aware. The film has a kind of famous or infamous history regarding its premiere. The audience, by and large, did not like it. A third of the audience actually left the theater. Stanley Kubrick had someone counting the number of people who were leaving the theater. He's very conscious about that matter, and it was something like 241 left before the end of the film. Rock Hudson apparently was one of the ones that left early. He said, "Can someone tell me what the hell this is all about?" Another critic complained, "So much money and brains expended on such a cold, unhuman, bloodless work." Victor Davis said of the premiere, "I've never seen a major film preview like it. There was not a single hand clap, not even from the studio men. The audience just rose, stunned and thoughtful, and shuffled out to the pavement." Sam Lesner saw the film two times in the first month or so and had two very different reactions to it. "I've seen Stanley Kubrick's mind-bending, maddening, awesome, debilitating, demoniacal, dehumanizing, and miraculous extraterrestrial fantasy drama twice. At first, I thought Kubrick had flipped his lid. Now I believe he's a genius." Interestingly, the film never did poorly in the box office. It was always selling very well to the general audiences. The audience that was at the premiere was comprised primarily of VIPs, and they tended to be a little more senior in years, and this film seemed to be a little bit too out there for many of them. But it did well in the box office, and two groups in particular, very different groups, had very positive responses to the film right from the start. One group were astronauts. The astronauts with the Apollo mission all went to see 2001 in the fall of 1968, and by all accounts, they appreciated it. Neil Armstrong praised its realism. "I thought 2001 was a very fine film, very authentic in terms of the way space looks and the way vehicles move and trajectories and so on." The Russian cosmonaut Alexei Leonov, who was the first to walk in space in 1965, said, "Now I feel I've been in space twice." The other group that responded very positively right from the start to this film were younger people of the 1960s kind of counterculture. John Lennon will be my first representative. He loved it. He said he sees it every week. Apparently David Bowie saw it a lot too and enjoyed it as well. In England, he says, "It was always presumed that Space Odyssey," his song about Major Tom, "was written about the space landing because it came to prominence around the same time. But actually, it wasn't. It was written because of going to see the film 2001, which I found amazing. I was out of my gourd anyway. I was very stoned when I went to see it several times, and it was really a revelation to me. It got the song flowing." One of the film's posters advertised 2001 as the ultimate trip. So I think it's interesting that both the Apollo astronauts and younger counterculture crowd responded so well to the film, probably predominantly for different reasons. But I think that these different reasons really speak to the strategy that Kubrick and Clark had to survive the Apollo program. And I'm referring up here to the problem that Clark realized pretty early in their work on it. Though NASA was spending their entire budget of our movie over $10 million every day, space exploration seemed to be marking time. But the portents were clear. I often remarked to Stanley that the film would still be in its first run when men were actually walking on the moon. So in writing our storyline in the early dawn of the space age, Stanley and I had a credibility problem. We wanted to create something realistic and plausible that would not be made obsolete by the events of the next few years. And so it seems that what Kubrick and Clark aimed to do was to work on the cutting edge of two different fronts. First of all, they wanted their film to be technically plausible. They wanted it to be a very believable portrayal of what it's like to go into space and to be in space. They also wanted this film to be very cutting edge in an avant-garde sort of way on the artistic front. And it seems that they did succeed in both of those endeavors. On the one hand, this film is very much about the how of space exploration. And I'm speaking about the first half of the film predominantly. It makes it, you know, they went to great lengths to get the technical details accurate. A lot of science fiction films up until that time had been invested in creating as plausible as they could science fiction films about space exploration with varying degrees of success. But what not a lot of science fiction films were focusing on are the whys of space exploration. Why are we going there in the first place? And this is what 2001 really was about, the hows of space exploration, but then also, just as importantly, maybe more importantly, the whys of space exploration. And I mentioned that science fiction films had not done much with the whys. Things to Come, which is a film based on H.G. Wells' book, concludes with a lunar mission. The Luddites of the film's story try to stop that mission from taking place. They're not successful. The mission gets off. And one of the technocrats speaks in a very rousing speech at the end about the choices that humanity has going forward. Either we can embrace the universe, either we can go out and seize the universe, or we can do nothing. So two very stark possibilities there. Destination Moon, have any of you seen Destination Moon? It's one of my favorites from the 50s. And it's almost a kind of documentary. It's part kind of rugged individualist, a guy building his rocket in his garage practically, and the government trying to stop him from succeeding. But it's also very much about just simply how to go to the moon by way of rocket. So there's a lot of basic physics that's explained. They actually use Woody Woodpecker to do some of that explaining. So it really is very much a kind of didactic, educational film as well as being entertaining. Regarding the whys of space travel, JFK, John F. Kennedy, in his famous speech of 1962, announcing his intention to take the United States to the moon, his reasons were, we choose to go to the moon and do the other things because not because it's easy, but because it's hard, because of the challenge of this endeavor. And this is a challenge we intend to win, as he says. So Kubrick was listening very carefully to these perspectives on space travel in the early 60s, and he was not satisfied. He wanted to make a film that would explore this subject in other ways. This is the genesis of the whole project. Right after the success of Dr. Strangelove, critical success and financial success, Kubrick decided his next project would be a science fiction film. He didn't actually know an awful lot about science fiction. He wasn't a science fiction enthusiast, so he started to do some early reading. And his friend, the jazz musician Artie Shaw, suggested he get in touch with Arthur C. Clarke, which he promptly did. And this letter from, I think it's March, the end of March, 1964, spells out what Kubrick, right from the start, was intending to do with this project. He says he wanted to make the proverbial really good science fiction film. And his assumption is that there weren't any really good science fiction films out there yet. Clark disagreed. In some further correspondence, Clark listed several films that he thought were pretty good, including Destination Moon and Things to Come, also Forbidden Planet and a couple of others. But Kubrick never respected Clark's taste when it comes to film. He thought that these were all horrible films. And I can quote him on that. Most of the people are treated like robots in these films. Cinema has let science fiction down. Most science fiction films are embarrassingly shallow and unconvincing, despite the fact that all kinds of interesting special effects techniques were now available. So clearly Kubrick saw this as a great opportunity to do something truly original in this genre. Michael Benson, by the way, on science fiction at this time, says, in the early 60s, science fiction was only a step or two above pornography on the social acceptability scale. I'm not sure I entirely agree with that, but I understand where he's coming from. So you'll also notice in this letter that Kubrick shows some interest in telescopes. He had been reading Sky and Telescope magazine and asked Clark for his advice on, you know, what would be a good scope. And then it turns out that Clark brought his personal scope to New York City. He was in Ceylon, traveled to New York City pretty quickly after this invitation. And the two of them, for the next several months, went to coffee shops, spent a lot of time with Kubrick's family in his penthouse, talking about all aspects of science fiction and science. And Clark could not have been a better teacher to get Kubrick up to speed. Clark mentioned that, as did practically everyone who worked with Kubrick, that he was an incredibly quick study, very, very attentive, very intelligent man, and he really would listen to you if he thought you had some ideas worth having, and then he'd pretty much soak you, you know, for all of those ideas that you're worth, and then do something else with them. But they got along very well and had a good friendship through most of this professional relationship. Clark says that Kubrick intended from a very early point to make a film with mythic grandeur, and he saw this as what the other science fiction films out there were not doing. He wanted to make a movie about man's humanity's relationship to the universe. So this was the main purpose from the outset. And there they are. It's Kubrick on the left. And Clark on the right. In order to achieve this mythic grandeur, they needed some good texts. And they decided pretty early on that Homer's Odyssey would be one of those foundational texts for this project. And the film is full of references and allusions and patterns as well from the Odyssey. Most obvious parallel would be the name of David Bowman, Bowman being a reference to Odysseus as the only one who can wield the bow of Apollo. Clark claims that they actually didn't intend that Bowman's name as a reference to the Odyssey initially, but they were overjoyed when they discovered it at a later point. But in other regards, I guess more fundamentally, the basic pattern of 2001 follows the monomyth that Joseph Campbell describes in his book, The Odyssey, being one example of that monomyth. And this is how Kubrick himself summarized Campbell's description of the monomyth, which you see in many different cultures and across the ages. A hero ventures forth from the world of common day into a region of supernatural wonder. Fabulous forces are there encountered, and a decisive victory is won. The hero comes back from this mysterious adventure with the power to bestow boons upon his fellow men. And so this is a basic pattern that Kubrick wanted to use for this film. They also turned to Nietzsche, and primarily for the three-part kind of structure of the film, starting with what Kubrick called ape men, because he went 4 million years back, and what Clark called man-apes, because he went just 3 million years back in his novel. But in any case, from the man-apes, ape-men, they move to, or Nietzsche moves to man, and then to what he calls the Übermensch. We're not going to get into all the philosophy behind this right now, but there's some question as to whether the Übermensch, Nietzsche's concept of this, corresponds to the Star Child with which this film and the novel concludes. Perhaps we can address that later. One other author I'll mention, one of my personal favorites, is Olaf Stapledon. Have any of you read him, Star Maker, by chance? It's very hard to describe Stapledon. In one of his earlier works, Last and First Men, he tells 2 million years of future history of humankind. And in Starmaker, he goes bigger, 2 billion years, and he tells pretty much the history of the whole galaxy and even beyond, the growth of a kind of galactic mind. And that mind becomes more perceptive, more aware, more intelligent, the more alien kind of individuals, the greater alien diversity it's able to include in this galactic mind. So it's a novel of incredible sweep, and Clark described it as the book, the single most important book of influence on his own career. So with this kind of hefty conceptual foundation, they proceeded, and the project became big quite quickly. One other thing I'll mention just in this introductory section is The Sentinel, a short story by Clark that Clark and Kubrick chose to be kind of the basic template for the film and the novel. The Sentinel falls into two parts. The first part is pretty pedestrian. Scientists are in a kind of roving lab. They go out for months on at a time. They're in Mare Crisium on the moon. And they're just doing their daily scientific work. But the really beautiful thing or interesting thing about the first part of the story is just how utterly ordinary and mundane this existence seems to be. The narrator describes the buzzing of razors in the morning, for example, and my favorite, the smell of frying sausages. And then he'll move to the window, and you'll just see this incredible lunar scape, the mountains of the rim of Mare Crisium. So that's the first part of the film. I would call it kind of the lunar mundane. And then the second part is the shock that occurs when the narrator sees a glint on the top of one of the mountains, climbs to the top of this mountain, in a pretty amazing description of lunar mountain climbing, and discovers that there's this perfect crystalline pyramid up there, which is immediately obvious that it's of alien origin. And he feels all kinds of conflicting emotions as a result of this revelation, including exhilaration, but also anxiety and fear. It seems that this pyramid is an alarm, and it's been set off, and the narrator ends the story speculating, wondering what might now be coming our way. Kubrick encouraged interpretation of his film, and so did Clark. Clark said he wanted us to think, and not necessarily the way that he and Kubrick think on what this film is all about. So what I would like to do is look primarily at two aspects of the film that are kind of intertwined. I'd like to look at how the film focuses in various ways on human knowledge, including technology, and how that is placed into relationship with the creation of some kind of a degree of experience with the alien unknown. And so human knowledge on the one hand and the alien unknown on the other. Look at the relationship between these two things in the film. So how many of you have not seen the film or read the book? Okay, not too many. I'll just go through a very quick plot summary. This is about as fast as I could manage. The film covers 4 million years of human evolution. It starts with ape men at the dawn of man, leaps to the year 2001, and then leaps again to an alien alternate reality, where David Bowman, the astronaut, transforms into a star child. Black monoliths, apparently of alien origin, are the cause of each evolutionary step. The first appears to the ape men and helps them to discover weapons. It kind of stimulates their imagination, makes them dissatisfied with their lot, and helps them to discover that they could use a bone as a weapon, and they prosper after that discovery. The next monolith is discovered and dug up on the moon in the year 2001. And once they dig it up and the sunlight hits it, it sets off an alarm. And that alarm sets off a signal that goes to Jupiter. And so the latter part of the film involves a mission to Jupiter to discover what is out there. And then we go through the Stargate and into a very trippy alien domain. So what I'm going to show you here is the very end of the Dawn of Man part of the film. And one of the most has famous cuts in all of our years, which spans 4 million years. Kubrick was manning the camera for the shot. So how to interpret that? If I just let this play a little bit, the music will give you some ideas of how to interpret it, but not the full story. Why choose the Blue Danube for this section? And I'm sorry, I've got my music up too high. Turn it down. So this scene is very much expressing the grace of space travel. It's expressing the confidence that humanity has achieved in venturing into space. Technology and culture seem to have melded, have come together in this scene in particular. And we see a kind of a dance here between this spaceship, which Haywood Floyd is in, and the space station to which he's going. Kubrick said, "It's hard to find anything much better than the Blue Danube for depicting grace and beauty in turning. I wanted something that would express the beauty and the grace that space travel would have, especially when it reached a fairly routine level, with no great danger involved. I wanted something that wouldn't sound too spacey or futuristic." And the Blue Danube, he says, gets about as far away as you can from the cliche of space music. People at first thought in the studio next to his that Kubrick was crazy when they heard this music playing for the science fiction film. But now, interestingly, a lot of us associate this waltz with space. So I'm going to go right... Sorry, take us back here. Something that's hidden under all the beauty and grace of this waltz and of this cinematography is what these spaceships are. And in Clark's novel, it's described in great detail. They're nuclear weapons. The Earth is rimmed with nuclear weapons all the way around, and humanity is basically facing a new possible extinction, a new crisis, much like the ape men experienced earlier in the film. But Kubrick does not make that crisis very obvious. There are some little military insignia on the spacecraft, which would suggest that these might be something other than just scientific craft. But otherwise, he is pretty subtle about the problem here. One other thing I'll mention about this scene. Is the mundane. I mentioned the lunar mundane, the frying sausages and the buzzing razors and so on. And this is one of the ways that Kubrick nods to that aspect of Clark's The Sentinel. And Clark also describes the toilet, the space toilet. I can't think of any other science fiction film that attends to this aspect of human reality, and even to today. So this is very definitely not Star Wars or Star Trek. And how exactly Floyd is going to remember all 10 of those instructions when he's actually in there, I'm not sure. But so a touch of humor. But again, this whole trip to the moon is utterly ordinary, very much like air travel is today. I have a Howard Johnson's, for example, on this space station that he stops at. The next part of the film goes to the moon, and there is a meeting at the space station in Clavius Base, in the crater Clavius. And then we have a trip on a moon bus from Clavius crater to Tycho crater, which is where the monolith has been unburied. This is a really fascinating part of the film because the transition is basically moving from the realm of knowledge and security and scientific confidence at Clavius Base to an utterly different scenario in Tycho. The fact that Christopher Clavius, was a 16th century mathematician and astronomer who ascribed to or signed on with Ptolemy still regarding the structure of the universe, believing that the Earth is at the dead center, and that Tycho Brahe, for whom Tycho crater is named, was much more invested in observational astronomy and did a lot to forward our understanding of astronomy by actually empirically looking with his eyes and taking very careful measurements and records about what he saw. We have a kind of shift from Clavius to Tycho from a kind of dated and mistaken understanding of the nature of the universe to we're heading at least in the right direction with Tycho. And that is where the monolith is found. Gregory Benford, I think, kind of gets at the transition that we're seeing here in this film in an article he wrote about aliens and science fiction. Often he says, the science in SF represents knowledge, exploring and controlling, and semi-safe. Aliens balance this desire for certainty with the irreducible unknown. A lot of the tension in SF arises between such hard certainties and the enduring atmospheric mysteries. Before we move on to the moon bus, I just wanted to play a little bit from Destination Moon, because this is the best lunarscape that we have in science fiction film up until 1968 and 2001. The artwork here is by Chesley Bonestell, who had been a prolific illustrator of spacescapes for throughout the 40s and the 50s. So I think what this panoramic lunarscape is trying to express or evoke is the old golden age, sense of wonder that science fiction enthusiasts expect, of their science fiction. There's the triumph of these astronauts who've just arrived on the moon. They're the first ones to get there. And otherwise, there's this very romanticized look at the moon. It's weird. Strange kind of note in the music, but really there's a sense of wonder, I think, that is being expressed here, inviting you to go out and explore this place. And there's the Earth looking kind of yellow. So this is before we had photographs of Earth from space. And I've just mentioned that this is what Kubrick had. So the original Earthrise in 1966, but there's no color. So he had to, you'll see his Earth is also not quite right when it comes to color, but it looks a little bit better than Destination Moon. This is the moon bus sequence. It's a different tone, traveling from Clavius to Tycho crater. And I don't think what's being evoked here is a sense of wonder so much. It's something a bit different. I'm going to turn the music up a little. This music is by Georges Ligeti, a Hungarian composer, who's made famous by this film. He went to see the film without knowing anything about it and was shocked and then very angered to discover that his music was used very heavily without anyone asking him permission. And so there was a lawsuit and there was a settlement, and then Ligeti became famous because of this film. But the music is text from the Roman Catholic Requiem Mass, so we have that Christian divine content reference. But if you didn't know what the singers were singing, you'd be understandable if you would mistake this for something very alien and not necessarily divine. And so it's a very kind of liminal space that's described here in this moon bus section. The next section is at the monolith, Tycho Magnetic Anomaly 1, is what it's called, TMA-1. The music is also by George Ligeti. Again, we have a Christian text behind it, but it sounds more alien to me. The kind of music that composition that Ligeti is employing here, his own invention, yes, I'm sorry, my fault, is called micropolyphony. And it was a new kind of music. It was a departure from 12-tone avant-garde music. It was a radical departure from traditional tonality and rhythm in music. And it interweaves the different voices in very intricate ways, creating masses of sound. But the effect is certainly that of some kind of, it sounds like something not of this world. I'll play a little more here. Destination Moon clip that I showed you was evoking a sense of wonder. I think what this clip is trying to evoke is a sense of the sublime, something that inspires a sense of awe, a sense of fear, and perhaps even terror, because it's utterly unknown what this thing represents. It's utterly perfectly smooth. The dimensions are very, very precise, and it's clearly not of this world. And the music kind of guides us into seeing this as something perhaps frightening. There's going to be an alarm. I'm going to turn it down before the alarm sets off because it's piercing. But we've transitioned now in the film from the comfort of known knowledge to something very unknown. I'm going to transition here. The subject of aliens is interesting. We know from his letter that Kubrick wanted to include aliens in this film from the very start. Early in 1964, Kubrick and Clark met together over dinner with Carl Sagan to talk about how aliens could be represented effectively, believably, in film. And Sagan's advice was, don't do it. You're not going to succeed. Sagan says, I suggested that any explicit representation of an advanced extraterrestrial being was bound to have at least an element of falseness about it, and that the best solution would be to suggest rather than explicitly to display. The film opened 3 years later. At the premiere, I was pleased to see that I had been of some help. In reality, Kubrick didn't like Sagan and did not take his advice at all and tried very hard for those next 3 years to come up with a convincing alien. He had a whole team of people, including his own wife, working on this problem. These are some of the best designs they came up with, it's probably a good thing they didn't proceed with any of these. So I think we wouldn't regard it with the same kind of appreciation that we do these days if they'd depicted the aliens. In retrospect, Kubrick said, that's one interesting thing about aliens. We can't satisfy our imagination, and there's nothing that would make you think, oh yeah, it's probably like that. No, nothing comes to mind that would astonish you beyond everything. I can't come up with anything that wouldn't bore me to death. And so we have to settle for the monolith and some kind of auditory alien sounds in the hotel room section at the very end of the film. This is the mission to Jupiter. I'm going to turn the music down. It's Khachaturian, and the music is suggestive of the general melancholy that this journey entails. There's two astronauts awake, three are in hibernation for the duration of the trip until they arrive at Jupiter. And Frank Poole, the character here, the astronaut, is running on a wheel that Kubrick had engineered. It was 38 feet in diameter, and it really did turn. And they had cameras mounted in various places on the inside of the wheel, and lighting and so on. It was a very, very expensive and complicated piece of filming equipment. The lights were breaking constantly, so there was glass all over the place, and it was very dangerous. And there was a fire hazard too, of course, being fueled into this contraption. But the general idea that this part of the film evokes is that it's a lonely place. It's necessarily lonely because the humans, the astronauts, in order to be successful on this kind of a mission, have to be very mechanical. They seem like well-oiled machines. They wake up precisely on time, even without the necessity of alarms. They do their jobs utterly efficiently. And Kubrick directed his actors here to perform with a very flat affect, to act almost like androids themselves. And they succeed. It was pretty hard for them to do that because they're both good actors, but you'll see a scene in a moment that shows them at work. The other way this part of the film is working is by having the computer, the artificial intelligence, known as HAL, seem much more human, actually uncomfortably more human than we're used to computers being. I'm going to jump ahead a little bit and let you hear HAL.
Although hibernation has been used on previous space efforts, this is the first time that men have been put into hibernation.
Beats 3 times a minute, 3 degrees centigrade.
Problem.
Well, I'm going to have to guess because I'm not seeing the time on here.
Doing extremely well.
Hal, you have an enormous responsibility on this mission. In many ways, perhaps the greatest responsibility of any single mission element. You're the brain and central nervous system of the ship, and your responsibilities include watching over the men in hibernation. Does this ever cause you any lack of confidence?
Let me put it this way, Mr. Raymer. The 9000 series is the most reliable computer ever made. No 9000 computer has ever made a mistake or distorted information. We are all, by any practical definition of the words, foolproof and incapable of error.
Hal, despite your enormous intellect, are you ever frustrated by your dependence on people to carry out actions?
Not in the slightest bit. I enjoy working with people. I have a stimulating relationship with Dr. Poole and Dr. Bowman. My mission responsibilities range over the entire operation of the ship, so I am constantly occupied. I am putting myself to the fullest possible use, which is all I think that any conscious entity can ever hope to do.
Dr. Poole, what's it like living for the better part of a year in such close proximity with Hal?
The interviewer there asks Dr. Bowman if he thinks that Hal can actually feel emotions, because he clearly seems to express them. And Bowman has to admit that we honestly don't know and can't really know an answer to that question. And so Hal is an artificial intelligence that seems to be moving very closely towards, quickly, towards consciousness, towards you know, various aspects that we associate with humans emotionally. His voice inflections and the ways that he puts things, not in the slightest bit, for example, there's something more going on there than data expression, the expression of simple data. And it's something like the uncanny valley, which usually we associate with robots that look human, very close to human, but they're not quite there. And it's the nearness of their appearance to the human that is unsettling and disturbing. And Kubrick has managed to achieve that with HAL purely in auditory terms, which is pretty interesting. The actor is a guy named Douglas Rain, Canadian actor, and Kubrick had him speak these lines barefoot and with his feet on a soft pillow in order to get the right kind of soporific voice effect. So HAL goes rogue, and this is the main kind of plot drama of the film. HAL has either made a mistake in reporting that a particular part would fail and needs to be replaced, or he's lied about this for various reasons. But he's been caught one way or the other, and it's a very uncomfortable situation. I think we have time.
Incredible, but this conclusion is based on the results from our twin 9000 computer. We are skeptical ourselves, and we are running cross-checking routines to determine reliability of this conclusion. Sorry about this little snag, fellas, and we'll get this info to you just as soon as we work it out. X-ray Delta 1, this is Mission Control, 2049er, transmission concluded.
I hope the two of you are not concerned about this.
No, I'm not, Al.
Are you quite sure?
Yeah, I'd like to ask you a question, though.
Of course.
How would you account for this discrepancy between you and the Twin 9000?
Well, I don't think there is any question about it. It can only be attributable to human error. This sort of thing has cropped up before, and it has always been due to human error.
Listen, Hal. There's never been any instance at all of a computer error occurring in the 9000 series, has there?
None whatsoever, Frank. The 9000 series has a perfect operational record.
Well, of course I know all I want.
Okay, I'll pause it there. Basically, what we're seeing here is our technology, or their technology, becoming something uncontrollable. And in fact, HAL, shortly after the scene, begins knocking off the astronauts one by one, first Frank Poole, and then the three that are in hibernation. And then David Bowman has to survive HAL's efforts to kill him as well before he's finally able to disconnect HAL. So this is technology pretty much getting the upper hand over its makers, and really, I think, also becoming a kind of alien unknown itself, because, as Bowman says, we don't really know what's going on in HAL's mind cognitively. Bowman does succeed in a very heroic-like fashion to defeat the Cyclops, which I think it's fair to connect or associate with HAL, with his single red eye. And then he is going to be the sole astronaut to complete the mission and to see what it is that signaled from out there orbiting Jupiter. In Clark's novel, the mission goes on to Saturn. And Kubrick tried very hard to make the film go to Saturn as well, but his art team just was not able to come up with a convincing Saturn at the time. I'll show you how they manage Jupiter. I think it's pretty amazing. The coloration is off. This is all broken for a couple. The music again is Georges Ligeti, his Requiem, which at this point in the film we associate with the monolith. And sure enough, the monolith shows up in just a moment. But we have Jupiter and many of its moons here. And David Bowman discovers that there is a monolith, skyscraper size, floating out there in space. And this is where the film becomes a bit trippy. A little bit of this play. Thank you. pacing of this film is kind of infamously slow. A stargate, a kind of portal, a wormhole, whatever it is, opens up just above the monolith, which you can see rotating there between the moons. This is the beginning of the famous stargate. So there's a number of things one could say about the Stargate sequence. Probably the less one says about it, the better. But one could talk about the technique that's being used here, which was developed by Douglas Trumbull. It's called the slit scan technique. And he adapted it from someone else, but did some new things with it. We could talk about Kubrick's technique for some of the later effects, which look like nebula. They look like the birth of stars and other kind of something between stellar activity and inhuman birth. And that's actually very interesting. Kubrick called it his Manhattan Project and used big vats of black ink, which he mixed in with banana oil, a kind of paint thinner. And then he flicked white paint and other colors with a toothpick into this mixture, and it created all of these, I'll jump ahead, all of these very strange effects. One. These are Kubrick's effects. And we're talking about the size of about a playing card. We could also talk about Kubrick's research into Walter Pahnke's Marsh Chapel experiments, where the participants took hallucinogenic drugs and attended a Good Friday service at Marsh Chapel in Harvard University, and experienced revelatory emotions and so forth that were indistinguishable from religious revelation. And they generally felt that the experience opened their minds to new ideas in all kinds of ways. So it seems that Kubrick was trying to use the sequence to achieve a similar effect. Even though, I should say, none of the art team were taking drugs when they made this sequence. It was pretty serious business. Also important to note here is that gradually we become really the viewers of this journey. And so David Bowman, the astronaut, fades from view. We see his eye there. And for the most part, we're experiencing this trip from the first-person perspective. I have no idea what these demons are. Lithium crystals? Oh, dilithium crystals. Okay. Speed us along. We have another part of this Stargate sequence that seems like alien landscapes. And I won't spoil it for you and tell you which landscapes they actually filmed. So I will just move on to the next segment of the film, which is where our astronaut arrives in a Louis XIV style French hotel room and is clearly rattled. I will play this so you can hear the sounds. Thank you. I'd always thought that those sounds at the beginning were alien sounds. It was Kubrick trying to express aliens actually kind of watching David Bowman here. Kubrick and Clark thought of this hotel room as a zoo that the alien overseers were keeping for various alien inhabitants. And so this hotel room is basically habitat for the Earthling. But those sounds that sounded like aliens are actually from another Ligeti piece of music called Aventures. And in that particular work, Ligeti is trying to use his singers, have them express sounds that have absolutely no semantic meaning. And the effect is that it sounds like it's alien meaning. But Kubrick had to do a little bit of distortion of that music in order to get the effect he has here. And he was sued for that. This is the part of the film that baffles most people. And if you're not already, if you haven't already left the theater by this point, this is still very baffling. David Bowman has aged very rapidly in a series of kind of moves where he sees himself around a corner at an older age, and then he becomes that older age. Pacing is slow. It's not good for a 50-minute talk, so I won't jump his head. He sees himself at an even older age there, and then sees once again the monolith, and then transforms into what we might call a cosmic fetus, or the star child. That's what Clark calls it. And this is where we get the most clear reference to Nietzsche and Thus Spake Zarathustra. This is from Richard Strauss' tone poem about Nietzsche generally. This is from the Dawn opening fanfare. And so this does raise the question of whether we're to understand David Bowman as a kind of Nietzschean ubermensch. And I think, just to simplify the matter, that there's a major problem with that kind of interpretation. Sorry. Well, you know the tune. But there's a complication or a problem for the Nietzschean interpretation of the end of this film, and that is namely that Nietzsche's Übermensch has not received any assistance from any kind of divine or otherwise outside or higher powers. His accomplishment has been achieved by dint of his own creative energies and will. And this scenario is obviously very different. Aliens have been involved from the very beginning, in the dawn of man, and then in 2001, and now here again, enabling this transfer to some kind of higher form of being, while David Bowman, to my eyes, seems very passive and is along for the ride. This echoes a story by Arthur Clarke called Childhood's End, where humanity transcends to a higher form of life, but again with the aid of alien intercessors, benefactors. So the Nietzschean reading is interesting, but it only works so far, and then it becomes problematic, unless you apply the Nietzschean reading to Stanley Kubrick himself. The film opens with the same music, and at its very climax, Stanley Kubrick's name appears on the screen, almost, you know, encouraging you to associate Kubrick himself with a kind of Nietzschean overman, expressing perhaps a great deal of optimism in the power of art. Right after this scene, when we get the opening credits, we're taken back to the Blue Danube Waltz music, which is again is a phase of humanity where we're moving in circles and we're in a state of nuclear crisis as well. So he takes us back to that earlier time and problem. I think I'm about out of time, but I just want to say one final thing that apparently is not often realized. At least I didn't realize it until I did some research into the matter. After Neil Armstrong stepped on the moon in 1969, July, the poets, or at least a lot of the poets, were not very happy about this fact. And the general, you know, the gist of their displeasure is expressed here. I'll just quote James Dickey. There's no moon goddess now. But when men believed there was, then the moon was more important emotionally. It was something a man had a personal relationship to, instead of its being simply a dead stone, a great ruined stone in the sky, which some poets thought it had become as a result of humanity stepping on the moon. Kubrick, I think, almost anticipated this problem, and the moon movie that he created kind of reinvests before the fact, before it's lost it, some manner of aura, some sense of the moon as a stepping stone to unknown, future possibilities out there in space. And the way he handles the moon generally definitely does invest it with a certain kind of grandeur and perhaps a touch of the sublime as well. It's interesting that one of the Apollo astronauts, after he got to the moon, said it was actually quite boring compared to Kubrick's film, and I wish it was much more like that. And I'll leave it at that. Thank you very much.
One more thing before we get to questions, I forgot to mention in my opening remarks. Next week we will be asking for your input and ideas. Your input and ideas for next year's series. So be thinking about it. We'll have forms for you to fill out, and we're working on also having an online form. We'll send all of the ticket purchasers who purchased through email, we'll send you the form, and you can fill it and send it back to us online if you have ideas for topics that you would like us to consider for next year's series. It's always helpful to have your feedback on that. We have a huge university here, and there's a lot of things we could talk about, but it's always best if we have something that you're interested in. So, with that, we'll have our question and answer. If you have a question, let me know. Either Angela or I will bring you a microphone. Who has a question? Oh, come on.
What was the relationship in time between the novel coming out and the film coming out?
Kubrick would not let Clark publish his... I'm sorry, who asked the question? Just so I can... Okay. He would not let Clark publish his novel for... it was almost 2 years. Clark had it pretty much ready to go, and Kubrick did not want the novel out before the film was released. And Clark was... he had some financial troubles, and he really wanted, the revenue that would come from this novel, and it did quickly become a bestseller. And everything was great. But it came out, I think it was the summer of 68, so it was after the film was released. I didn't talk about sort of the relationship between the novel and the film, which is an absolutely fascinating aspect of this whole collaboration. Kubrick used the novel as a way, the writing of the novel, as a way of learning the subject for this story that he was going to tell in film. And so he and Clark wrote the novel together initially, talking about it chapter by chapter, and Kubrick always retained editorial rights over Clark's manuscript. But once Kubrick went into production and kind of had found his way with the story, he didn't bother Clark with edits anymore or suggestions. He let Clark do what he wants to do, and Kubrick did what he wanted to do. But just this idea of the novel is pretty much was, as Clark put it, it was like the booster, the first booster stage of a rocket. That's what Clark was in the novel. And then once that was up, Kubrick was on his way and he did his own thing.
I'm just curious, the depiction of a zero gravity flight was really well done, and yet everybody exhibits the effects of gravity, from the spinning space station to the guy shadow boxing around in the wheel, and people sitting and eating meals, and there's no attempt to depict zero gravity in those situations, and we don't make any attempt to establish gravity in our space stations or trips. And the second, any comment about that? And the other comment, why would they go to Jupiter? I mean, it's a gas giant. Does that make any sense? Go to one of its moons, but...
Yeah, regarding that second question, Clark did a lot more with the Saturn destination because he suggested that the rings of Saturn are actually a result of the making of the Stargate. So the engineering involved, it required the kind of energy that I suppose a moon was destroyed in order to make the Stargate. And that's what the rings of Saturn are, according to Clark. But yeah, unfortunately, Kubrick wasn't able to get out there. They just couldn't do a convincing Saturn. Saturn. So, but yeah, the Stargate is just orbiting around Jupiter. So some people mistakenly think that the Stargate takes Bowman into Jupiter, but that's not the case at all. And in Clark's novel, it's a very different handling of the Stargate. Bowman goes into what is called a Grand Central Station, which is this vast area. The stars are white and the sky, the stars are black and the sky is white. It's like a photographic negative. And there are wormholes going off in all directions. And the scale is just unbelievable. So, and your other question, Clark devotes a lot of attention to the specifics of, like food and zero gravity, the stickiness. You got to have a lot of like sauces that are adhesive, for example. And he goes into great detail about things like that in the book. It looks like, it's hard, without special effects we have these days to make zero gravity believable. So you have Haywood Floyd when he was sleeping on the rocket, the shuttle, just kind of doing his hand. And I suppose he just did that just sort of himself, without any special effects beyond that.
Okay, other questions? Was the name HAL chosen because it's one ahead of IBM? Is that a true story?
No. Well, according to Kubrick and Clark, that's not the origin of the name at all. It's heuristic algorithmic computer, and so the H is heuristic, and then AL, from algorithmic. And they always maintain that story that it was not IBM displaced by one letter. Whether they're telling the truth or not, I don't know. But I should mention, by the way, that today is apparently the 30th anniversary of the Internet. And they said on NPR this morning that you should never trust anyone over 30. And there are fears of Google waking up someday as an artificial intelligence.
I was wondering, I remember the awe and the fear of watching the movie the first time, and I wish I had you to explain it all. But and my oldest son is two months older than you are. It's interesting. But I remember thinking at the time that when he becomes a star child, to me it seemed like reincarnation. It seemed. So is that kind of the interpretation?
Reincarnation? I'm not sure. That's certainly a possibility. It seems to me, if we were to go to Nietzsche, Nietzsche tells the story of the three metamorphoses of human evolution through the camel, through the lion, and then through the child. And so some people think of it in those terms. The star child is the last of those metamorphoses. So reincarnation would take us, I'm not sure, where would that go? It seems that the star child is going, this way, if we, take, Clark, his work generally, as a guide. And the way Clark explains this in the novels, the star child returns back to Earth and very quickly blows up all the nuclear weapons around the planet, solves that problem. And then what is he going to do next? He'll think about it, is how the novel ends. In keeping with Childhood's End and the Stapledon, Olaf Stapledon kind of base, probably we're heading off, or he's heading off to other intelligences around the galaxy.
Okay.
Can you speak about Arthur C. Clarke's position as a science fiction writer in the genre? He was, I think, credited with being incredibly foresighted with respect to the development of technology. For example, telecommunication satellites in geosynchronous orbit was an idea that he was really the first one to write about. Things about 2001 and other of his works that seem to have come true.
Sure. Yeah, Clarke was incredibly well-versed in science and was consulted regularly, you know, for documentaries. And he was present for the Apollo 11 landing on TV, you know, next to Walter Cronkite. He was there as one of the experts on television. And his stories and his novels are as hard science fiction. So he really was attentive to, you know, the physics and the hard science behind you know, all the phenomena in his novels. And in addition to being an incredible poet, I think that 2001 is some of the greatest poetry, you know, space-oriented poetry that I've seen anywhere. It's incredibly moving. But he's a kind of figure unto himself. He was off in Ceylon for much of his career, so he wasn't, well, I mean, he got around, but he really was not following the trends. You can't really lump him into another like school of science fiction. Heinlein is a similar kind of figure. He was kind of doing his own thing and became one of the kind of the fathers of golden age science fiction. But he's one of my favorites, Clarke is, and it's because of that combination of the hard science, which is plausible, and I believe him. It doesn't take a lot, you know, for me to my suspension of disbelief to kick in with science fiction, but Clarke is really good at doing that for me, and then the poetry is really what makes it.
Thank you. As you might guess, I'm more interested in Clarke than I am in Kubrick. And what I was thinking of while you were talking about the call it the quasi-philosophical aspects of 2001, Clarke, left to his own devices, had several years earlier in the 50s, early 50s at one point, done that far future forecasting kind of thing. In actually the first of his novels I read, Against the Fall of Night, which was later, he later revised and republished as The City and the Stars. Well, it's Against the Fall of Night that I remember best, and in that there is interstellar travel, differently done. There's a spaceship rather than a gate, etc. And the astronaut is accidental. He's not really an astronaut. He's just trying to get away from home. But the philosophical part is picks up on something that's also there with Hal in 2001, and that is that at some time in the really dim and distant past, an intelligence had developed in space without needing a planet, which turns into something that Clarke's characters call the mad mind, which doesn't like matter at all and wants to wipe out all matter. And our hero meets a kind of star child that is really a star child, even given a name. Anyway, it ends up with our hero taking that child mind to the center of the galaxy and turning it loose, thinking that eventually, way down the line, the child, Vanamonde, as the hero calls him, will meet the mad mind among the corpses of the stars, because it was already clear to Clark at that point that the universe, as we know it, would not go on forever. I just wonder if Clark ever talked to Kubrick about the real future of the universe and the human race.
Are you talking about heat death?
Hmm?
Are you talking about heat death, the real future of the universe?
Well, we end up with the Star Child.
Uh-huh.
And the movie leaves the star, as you said, the movie leaves the Star Child's future activities
mm-hmm.
untouched.
Mm-hmm.
Clark did not, in that very early novel, and even less so in the follow-up, The City and the Stars, several years later. I am curious, mm-hmm. this is where I would put Kubrick back in the frame, I'm just wondering whether Clark might have talked to Kubrick about a real far future
okay.
development post-Star Child.
I know for a fact they talked about infinity, the concept of infinity, which interested Kubrick a great deal. Where that went exactly, I'm not sure. And are you wondering if Kubrick was satisfied with the scope of this film, or is he... mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a really interesting question. I mean, Kubrick, you know, went off. I mean, he was doing Clockwork Orange, you know, so he was going in new directions. He was not going to stick with science fiction. I like that. I like the point, and I think that Kubrick, or rather Clark, in many ways was he benefited from working with Kubrick, but he didn't go as far as he could have gone, you know, of course, with this particular narrative. So, and then if you read Olaf Stapledon, you see the possibilities are even beyond these. But
Clark did, right?
I'm sorry?
Clark knew Stapledon.
That was his favorite author. Yeah.
Unlike The Godfather, which benefited from having a sequel, this movie had a sequel starring Roy Scheider, I think. 2010 was the name of it.
Yes.
Would you comment about that unfortunate outing?
I like that film. I mean, they get Jupiter better, for sure. It's a pretty stunning Jupiter. Clark goes on, you know, with 2061 and then the last, what is it, 3001. That particular film, it's different. It's just totally different. It's definitely not Kubrick. Clark liked it himself. It's Hal is brought back from the dead, and of course Hal never really died, but he's revived, and Jupiter becomes a star. It basically implodes or condenses to become a small star itself. And so we have two stars at the end of that film. So they're nice touches, but I haven't seen that in a number of years, and I think after studying 2001 closely, it probably will be, it'll be notable, you know, that it wasn't Kubrick that did that film. It's Peter Hyams, I think.
Any other questions? You usually have a question. There you go. A regular.
I was just wondering, what effect did this have on the society of the American people when it comes to the actual moon landing? And maybe how many people in this room were skeptical or did not believe that that we actually did land on the moon when this film came out?
Yeah, one of the theories is that Kubrick was the director of the kind of fake lunar, you know, sets that NASA supposedly, they staged the lunar landing. So that's one of the theories that's out there. Kubrick's daughter spoke up about this not too long ago, and she said If you know my father's work, you know his films, you know his attitudes about government and large organizations and so on that are oppressive to human rights, that you couldn't for a second believe that he would participate in such a conspiracy. And I tend to agree with that. Kubrick had tremendous integrity, plus his sets are not that good. You know, frankly, he would have done something better. More generally, you're wondering what kind of an effect this film had on American culture. I think people in this room would probably know many better than me in answer to that question. I'm really a Renaissance scholar and science fiction enthusiast, and I was quite young, you know, in those early years right after it. But I will say that after the lunar landing, science fiction turned away from lunar fiction for a while. I study this pretty closely, and there's a sudden drop-off in stories and novels about the moon right after 1969, and they begin to pick up again in the later 80s, and then in the 90s you start to have stories about, you know, why aren't we going back to the moon, you know, in a very critical kind of perspective. Why are we just remaining in low Earth orbit with the space shuttle? And so there's various kind of stories about getting back to the moon using private companies to do that. So lunar fiction is kind of taking off again with that new focus on private individuals and rugged individuals going back to the moon, private corporations and so on. So I'm not sure if that answers your question.
Any other questions?
I'd be interested in your perspective on maybe an incorrect observation, but it seems to me that all science fiction movies regardless of how far the intelligence travels and goes in the futuristic humans or aliens, they always carry with them the same basic prejudices and the lust for power and the control, and even this is hinted at in HAL. Do you have a perspective on why that always happens? They never go past the basic problems.
Lack of imagination, I think. I've taught a few classes actually on the alien in science fiction, and the one thing you keep coming back to is you just really can't represent the alien. It's an impossibility. You suggest, you try. It's a good exercise to try because that potentially gets you, or at least gets you trying to get beyond your prejudices and your anthropocentric perspectives. And to think differently. But inevitably it's going to be, I shouldn't say inevitably, we don't know, but most likely something beyond what we can imagine right now. Clark in 2001 suggested five different possibilities for aliens. They could be humanoid. Actually, Kubrick thought that they would be humanoid, and Clark said, no, you're way out of date. After Darwin, the aliens became much more, you know, complex and interesting and suited to their environments and not very often not humanoid. Or they can be not humanoid, number two, or they can be conglomerations of body and machine, or they can transcend body and become pure spirit. The fifth possibility Clark suggests is can only be God, and so there you see, you know, very typical of Clark and people like Olaf Stapledon, a kind of blurring between science and religion. We haven't seen any aliens yet, we can speculate.
Okay, one final question.
I'm a little distressed by this final slide, which
no, I'm sorry,
suggests that knowledge of some place ruins it, and that sort of goes against what a scientist would think about it. And I'm trying to think of other literary examples of that same kind of idea. And the only one I can come up with is The Wizard of Oz, where at the end the wizard is shown to be just a man pulling ropes behind a curtain. I wonder if you have other examples of that kind of notion where knowledge ruins mystery.
I do. In John Milton's Paradise Lost, angel Raphael tells Adam, who asks all of these astronomical questions, he says to Adam, don't seek other worlds, don't seek knowledge of how it all works, be lowly wise, keep your feet on the ground. And Adam accepts this. This is in a poem after we've already seen the character Satan fly light years from hell to our world. And we see this unbelievably large-scale universe that and poetically described by Milton. And then we're told to not dream of other worlds. And it's a total rebuke. And I can't help to think that Milton doesn't really mean that, tempting us with curiosity about such things and then saying, don't think about it. But that's one example, kind of a counterexample. But yeah, I'm sorry, I don't agree with this. And but there is a lot of fiction and poetry that is in this vein.
Great. Well, let's thank Rob one more time, and I'll see you next week for our final lecture.